Wow, what an honor to have you here. And Eric did a great job, and I'm honored that he came up and he did that and spoke for you. And it's in the past now, so it's non-existent. Everything Eric just did is literally fictional now. It's not happening at all. And don't even know why I wasted his time, really, because there was no point in it. But maybe one day I'll do another thing and it'll matter then, but that's future. So that even there's no hope really, because it's a waste of his time. Really. He's totally wasted his life. I'm honored to be here. I am taking in, you know, the first couple minutes, you just want to take in that you guys did this. You guys got on planes and you're legitimizing what I know is true. What I'm doing, you're making me feel permission to do this, and that's really crazy, you know, and I'm very thankful for you, because you doing that, like, gets this to come out of me more, and the first minute is the only minute that I've been anticipating, and which is an illusion, right, because I was like, oh, what am I going to say, because I have no idea what I'm going to say, which I'm sure will make you thrilled you paid to get here. I have no clue. I have no idea what to say. The real reason we're here is I've dated most of you, and I just think we should figure this shit out. You know, we have 3 days to, everyone who's talked crap about another ex, we can just look at each other and say it. And it's so funny. I do these things very differently. You know, I don't, the typical seminar thing, I don't do. Like, they're already asking me, what song do you want to walk up to? And I'm like, I literally was like, do you have the theme to Schindler's List? And no, we can't, we don't have that in our playlist usually, you know. So they don't have that. But I'm just starting right now, and it's funny because there's a comedian in me that usually holds a mic, and I did the last event, and I started out holding a microphone, and I have a long story about that, but I'm comfortable holding a microphone, and my amazing manager, Norma Lajum, is here, and he's like, I want you to do this, because, you know, I need to have my hands free, but this is a very empty feeling for me, because I'm used to having it, but isn't that an illusion, right? That's not real. Like, I can't talk. It's not like I need to hold the microphone everywhere I am. I don't go pee like this, you know what I mean? That'd be a weird thing. But it'd be weirder as if two munchkins came in here same time on a unicorn spear, and they're like, what's up, I'm Oprah. That's an old bit of mine, but I just felt like doing it, because that's what came through. And if you don't like it, it was God that said it, because it came through me. So it's your resistance to that I did that. So take in that maybe you're an ego, and if I do anything and you don't like it, if I do anything and you don't like it, it's your ego that's deciding that I shouldn't be doing it, and I was supposed to, because I did. And so you need to think about what your ego's saying. And if you have any problems at all with any of this event, it's your ego, and you should need to let go of it. So you have no room to complain at all. There's no possibility of you being upset, because it's just not real. In fact, what you're complaining about was in the past. So I could literally come out here naked and say nothing for 3 days. And if you complain, it's your ego that's talking. And so that all just came through. like that's what happens, is that's how flow works, right? It's just start. And it's so funny, because the very first moment is the hardest moment, because you're coming out of a place where you've been training your mind, right, to want stuff. Your mind wants stuff. You go on Facebook, and that's all we do. We go on Facebook. Well, most of us wake up now and just scroll through the news feed, and we just see the same crap, and we scroll. And what are you doing in that moment? You go on, you wake up, and you scroll through the news feed, and there's just crap that you have nothing to do with, and we like to get involved with. Justin Bieber got punched by a basketball player, everybody, and you post it, right? So many people even know what I'm talking about. That's like, I saw people like, yeah, I know that story specifically, you know? Like you know what I'm talking about. I know about dumb Starbucks. You know about the same things that we've all posted, and there are all these things that have happened, and we've gotten our mind, it's got all this fuel to care about stuff that has nothing to do with us. That has nothing to do with this. And we do this all day. And then your mind goes, now who do I call and make sure that someone likes me? And now who do I, you know, what did that person say about me? And all these things happen, and they could just be passing things. And you bring yourself into it. Could you imagine if you did that with just natural things, like the ocean? You know, like the wave's in. Okay, I'm going to make sure it goes out. Okay, it's coming back in again. Like, you don't do that, right? You don't get involved there. And weirdly, it knows what it's doing. And so does everything else. But you might not understand that. And there's a flow that's trying to come through all the time. And I realized, and I'm learning for myself, that flow can't come through if you're in your head about anything in the past and future. If you're stuck in the past about something someone did, there's insights that can't come through because you're busy thinking about something over here and you're saying, that's more important than the things that are trying to come through me right now. Like right now, what's happening is what's coming up for me. And it's coming up for me because this week, when I practiced for this event, I didn't think about what I would say. I cared about what I was doing in the moment. That was how I practiced. So if it's Tuesday and I had the event coming up Friday, I don't sit here and go, what am I going to say? I mean, every once in a while it showed up and I would feel tense because I don't know. How can I envision how a 3-day event is going to go? I have no idea how it's going to go. So I have to just let go and go back into the moment because in that moment I'm going, oh, the future is more important than right now, right? And all the time we think that the future is more important than right now or the past is important than right now, more important than right now. And all that is here is right now. And it sounds so corny. We hear all the time this stuff like, oh, you know, just live in the moment, you know, and we pass it around on our Facebook memes and then we bitch about our ex all day and it's totally not real. There is a moment that's a real thing. And what if there actually is a real thing that's the moment and you actually could learn to be in it and you could actually learn that anything outside of it is an illusion? And when you started to actually understand, and I mean actually because we hear this stuff all day, just live in the moment, and we go, yeah, and then we pass it around and say that, and then we don't do it. And so this event is going to be different because I'm going to give you guys a lot of experiences and a lot of different things, and I want you, this is going to be much more participatory than the last one. The last one was really cool, and we did it in a much bigger room. But this, I wanted more intimacy. And the comedian in me likes the walls that are more narrow so the acoustics bounce off. But I want to get to know most of you. There's a few people I don't want to meet. But I'm really looking forward to getting to know. There's 80 people I'd like to meet. And if you're outside of that 80, like I really would like it if you don't come near me or talk to me or say hi or thank you. I hate thank you. But everyone else in the 80, please do. And it's going to be these people. I'm just kidding. That'd be weird. It's this group right here. There's still 50 people that haven't come in here yet because Eventbrite decided to tell everyone it's at 3 is when this event starts, and I don't know why. And we keep changing it, and Eventbrite's like, no, it's going to start at 3. We're like, no, we know when it's going to start. And then the people at Eventbrite are like, how do you even know time's real? And I was like, why are you throwing my crap at me now? You know, so... So there's still people that are coming. So if you don't like your seat, this is your chance to move forward because you can move forward and get a better seat. And then we just say those people that showed up at 3, hey, you're the idiot who believed Eventbrite and not me. So they can sit in the back. But you guys didn't know what to think of that. You're like, she said idiot and we're a spiritual group. So, but feel free to move however you want because after that, I mean, well, and all day you're going to go to breaks and come back. If I decide to go on a break, we only have breaks if I have to pee. And I don't because I'm in the moment and I forget about peeing on all kinds of stuff. So really, this is it until Thursday. You know this event goes till Thursday, right? So we're very excited to have you here until Thursday. So I feel so good already because what's happening is I'm showing myself, hey, remember, when you just show up and start, it all comes through. Because it's just happened right now. So if you have something coming up and you're anticipating it, realize you're already in an illusion because you don't know what's going to happen. Everything I just said, I swear to God, I had no clue I was going to say, except for the thing about dating. I thought of that earlier, but that I dated all of you. But like, I didn't. I haven't dated you, bro. But if I had, I would have. So I'm in love with this. I'm really feeling you. I'm feeling you. I'm feeling you because you're making me feel good and the audience is good and tight and I can feel your reaction and I can tell this is going to be a massive, amazing weekend of just co-creating. And what I mean by that is just throwing ideas around and just being open to meeting other people in here and realizing, you know, when you're in your head, you're in the future, you a lot of times don't realize how many assets you have in the moment because you're sitting here going, well, I have to do something really good later. Like, could you imagine if I was doing this event, but Monday night I found out I'm performing for Barack Obama or something like that? Well, if I wasn't where I am now, I'd be going, okay, how do I get good at that? And I might not realize how many things that I want to say here that are so amazing, right? So, but if I realize that all moments are literally even, whether you're here, whether you're peeing, whether you're on a date, whether you're on stage, whether you're doing something that could be worth $10 million, it's just as important as that time when you're lying down. It's all the same thing. And so when you do that, the most amazing stuff can happen, but you have to get yourself out of the way to let these things happen because you might be in your head going, oh, I hope this goes well, or I don't know what I'm going to get out of this. But do you realize that every single person in here is an asset for you? If you ask it, I mean, clearly they're an asset for me. right? Every single person in here is wanting to work with me. You're here working with me. We're working together right now. And you also are now in a room full of people who are wide open to possibilities, and we're going to open them more, and they're going to open me more. And what we're going to do is that we're just going to get into a flow where ideas show up. You want to start a business, you're going to find people in here that are like, oh, I have a list of 200,000 people, or I'm a producer for a TV show, or, you know, you might just want to get out of something, and you'll find that there's 30 life coaches in the room, and they want to help you too. And, you know, there's people I know in here that are so magical and special in my life that I already know that exists, like Scott Carlin's in the back, who's a producer. He produced Rosie O'Donnell's show on the Oprah Channel, and he's done all kinds of other things. Kelly Carlin's here, and they're not related, weirdly, but... Kelly Carlin's here, and Norma Ladjum, my manager, and there's so many people I know in here. Ron, the owner of Sun Cafe, is here. Like, that's awesome. That's an asset I didn't realize I had. Can I tell him what we did, Ron? Can I tell him? Okay. So last December, I was just kind of thinking to myself, I really like this restaurant, Sun Cafe. I'm a big, you know, I like to eat raw, organic, you know, vegan food quite a bit, you know, because it makes you healthier. And everyone goes, oh, you're so extreme and crazy. And then they eat 94 Oreos and call me crazy. But it's so weird. Ron said something so interesting to me. And I'm not preaching that you have to do this, but it is a fascinating thing that there's 8 million species and only one of them cooks, right? And we're so extreme to be eating the crap that comes off the trees. Oh my God, how weird that we're eating what nature's trying to give us and not microwaving it and sticking bacon on it. And like, but I so support whatever you're, if there's people like, oh, is this a raw vegan thing? I'm not Trojan horsing you into becoming a raw vegan. You can eat whatever you want. But I just was at this December, I was just like, you know, I really love Sun Cafe, and I it's this place by my house, and I wrote Ron, and I said, hey, I really love your place, and I said, if I promote you at different places I speak at, and if I speak about you on my podcasts and different things like that, I'd like to come in there for 90 days, and I'd like to bring a different amazing person. Could I come in there, and would you guys feed us? And he goes, yeah. All I did was ask, right? So it was beyond money. Right? It was beyond, because we always think, well, what am I going to gain? Now, right there, you already have an insight, because most people think money is our God. We think it's the most important thing. And some people go, no, I think love's more than money. Well, then you'd be giving every homeless person $100 every time you pulled off a freeway, right? But we go, no, I got to hoard money. I got to get this in. I got to hoard the things in my house. I got to have a basement full of 100,000 things and boxes and stuff like that. Now, let's look at nature and how nature works with our body. Could you imagine if you thought the rule of life was your job is to eat as much food as possible and get as much in and don't shit anything, just keep eating? You know, and if you did want to crap, you need to have a coupon to make sure very little crap comes out. And you're just in there. No, you know what? That's not how it works. And because of that, you finally go and you have room to make more money or more food. Because I eat money, by the way. So, but it's raw vegan money and it's really delicious and it's healthy because I'm so tired of this cooked, you know, microwaved dollars. But there's just an obvious flow there. Now, I find that if you're hoarding anything at all, you're also, that's the same party that's hoarding your ideas. There's a flow that of ideas that's happening. And I've noticed that I've worked with comedians for, I've been a comic for an or a speaker for 24 years. And I've worked with so many different speakers. I'm actually more comfortable on stage than off. If you meet me in person, I'll be like, get away or at least give me a microphone. But in on stage, like I go on and I see these things, and I notice that there's a lot of times, sometimes, you know, a lot of comics, they have a thing where they're in a place where their job is to find what's wrong with the world, right? So that's our job. Comics like make fun of everything, right? Well, a lot of times we're cynical about all kinds of stuff then. But sometimes I'm cynical about my doubts. You know, I have that same wanting to be authentic too, but I'm cynical about my doubts. So if the thing goes, oh, you can't run an event for 3 days, what if that's BS, right? That's where I'm cynical about. And it's not some corny, magical, like I'm sitting here going, you can make it happen. I know it's a fact that you're unlimited. It's just a fact to me because I've been limited in my life and then I've taken leaps and started learning how to listen to that guidance. And it's a totally different thing. I've opened like 3 doors and not finished the story. But so I wrote Ron and said, hey, can I come into Sun and eat there each day? And he said, yeah. And what happened after that was I decided to find a different amazing person every day and go to Sun Cafe. And I spent like a couple weeks, I've been on the road lately so I haven't been able to as much, but I spent a couple weeks just taking an amazing person and just sitting with them for 2 hours and talking to them. And so much work has come out of it. so much, because each person, when you have a one-on-one, we live in a world where everybody's texting and emailing and everything, right? So when you sit here and you have a one-on-one with someone, they start going, oh, how can I bring you into my life? Or how can I add you to this? So people are offering me different parts in movies. And I ended up on Bob Proctor's stage last week, and or a couple weeks ago. And I and ended up, a lot of tickets ended up being sold to people from Bob Proctor's event in this room. But all these things stem because I just showed up and didn't know what was going to happen, but I was okay with that. And one of the biggest things I want to offer to you is, be willing to show up, don't know what the results are going to be, but be okay with that. Now, that might sound like a lot of conflict to what we've heard, where you hear things like The Secret, where they say, picture what you do want. And that is a great way to do it, but if you do that, you're still stuck in your mind, right? You're taking your mind, and I'm not against that, too. That's a great step up. In fact, we're going to do all kinds of things that show you all kinds of different ways to do this. But if you're in your mind, and you're going, okay, if I'm in my mind picturing how this event's going to go well, let's say I scheduled this in, like, November, right? So if I, in my mind, was like, okay, here I'm going to do this, here's how I'm going to do it, and I started it in November, I'm already blocking out all the possibilities that are going to show up in December and January, because I'm already in November doing it from the limited perception of myself in that moment. So if you're making a vision board for yourself, that's great, but realize you're making the vision board based on what you perceive right now you could do. And I know you could do way more than it. Because you're bringing in all these stories about you that, you know, well, I know that I make $50,000 a year, so I'm going to make a vision board that I'm making $200,000 a year. Because that seems like a good enough jump. But what if it's, and money doesn't matter at all, but what if it's, you could make $1 million in a week? You're already feeling resistance to that because your mind has a story about who you are. But if you say to someone in Bob Proctor's group or someone like Bob Proctor from The Secret, he's like, oh, yeah, you can make $1 million in a day. You know what I mean? Like, that's what he's like. You should hear him talk. It's the weirdest thing. I spoke at this event the other day, and he was talking about meditation. And if you hear him talk, he's literally like, like, if you go driving with Bob Proctor and it's his first time in a car, he'll be like, it's the craziest thing. You turn to the right, the car goes to the right. You turn to the left, it goes to the left. You know, it's like, ah, you're going to teach meditation? So, see, just picture him being, let it go. Like, oh, okay, I didn't know. That's ego. Okay, I'm sorry, it was the ego. You're only now. Okay, stop it, please. I have to throw these pants out altogether. So, but, but when... when you, if I'm sitting here from the beginning going, okay, I'm going to do this event, and I start going, how do I do it? I'm bringing the how up from the limited perception of what I believe myself to be. And I know that that's not the case because you're bringing in your past, and your past has to be fictional. You might bring it into your life all day, but you don't have to. And at one point I realized people say who I am is my past all the time when they just say a little thing, well, I'm a procrastinator. Or, well, I have a hard time with relationships. Or, you know, I do this thing with this, or I do this thing. And all the time, they're saying this thing about them that's only from the past, right? I'd love to, but I have this thing that I in me that I can't get over. Well, you just re-energized it. You just re-brought it back in again. I wish I could, but a while ago I went through this thing, or I'm always a messy person. No, what if your belief about yourself is I'm unlimited change? Or only this moment? What if your just belief about yourself is that? How different would it be? Because people all the time re-energize this I am and then a limitation. Even an I am positive thing is a limitation in my eyes. Well, I'm worth $1 billion. Shoot, I'm worth way more than that. You know, money doesn't matter to me, but I'm using that as a measurable example for you guys to see that. And I know money doesn't matter because I've gotten to make a lot of it as a stand-up comedian for years. One of the things that Jim Carrey said at an event that I did with him that I really loved was he said, I wish you guys could have all these things that I've gotten to experience because you'd see you're chasing the wrong thing. You're chasing the wrong thing. I swear to God, there's a reason that comics a lot of times and actors and people that are huge end up becoming drug addicts or very spiritual, right? Because a lot of times they get to experience that abundance that you think that you want, and you're chasing this thing. And I promise you on my life, I got there. And what happens when you think you want something? How does it work? You go, I really want this thing. I got to have this thing. Well, if you want the thing, you're already out of alignment with it because you're already saying it completes you, which means you're saying you're incomplete without the thing, right? So you're already putting yourself in lack. That's what we do all the time. You go on a date with someone. If you really want them, you suddenly can't talk. But you can talk when you're alone, right? But you can't talk all of a sudden because you think you want that person. But that's not your natural state. When you were a kid, you didn't have that, right? So if you're saying this person completes me, you're already saying I'm incomplete without the thing. If I want this show to go perfect this weekend, I'm already incomplete and I'm a total slave to the show, which will mean I actually can't do as well, right? So if I sit here all day and picture that this event is going to be the greatest thing in the world and everything like that, that's great, that's really cool, but it's, and I'm sure it would be, but it's nothing compared to what can happen when you actually allow this stuff to flow through. When you actually allow yourself to show up and totally let go of the idea that you need to know how it's going to work, you know, that you need to know how it's going to work. Because who wants to know how? The old story of you, the limited story. Why do you need to know how? Because you want to match what you thought you used to be, or you want to be able to beat it. Because in your mind, evolving happens if you do that. But you could just evolve by letting go, right? So this event right now that's happening is me teaching myself. Literally, there's two of you. There's no question there's two of you. There's a you that doesn't know how to do something. Like, where should we go to a restaurant? I don't know. What should we, where should we go to a restaurant? Why did I, the restaurant. there's a you that goes, where should we go? I don't know how to do this. What do you guys think? Should I wear this outfit? I don't know what I should do. And then there's another you that someone you know could be going through something. And you can sit there and give them the greatest advice you've ever said in your life for 3 hours. You could have written a book with that, right? So who are the two yous? Why did that second you show up then? And one of the reasons that second you showed up is because you weren't trying to get anything from the other person. If I have a goal to get anything from you, I'm going to be a much more limited seminar. And in my eyes, not to be a douchey guy and call out stuff, but there's a ton of those. There's a ton of seminars that say, here's how you do it, and they hand you a bunch of tactics. Do you know what I mean by that? They say, here's what you do. You go, okay, you go, here's how it works. You go on here and you just write this. Or I've even seen people go, here's how you get a video to go viral. And they're like showing you how to buy views, right? Or you just buy views and you stack it. It says 200,000. You create a big hype. You get all this stuff and everybody likes you. Well, yeah, but you just got a bunch of views that doesn't match the product. Because the views will go up naturally if it's that good, right? So instead of cutting corners and trying to create a fake foundation that you won't be able to even work from because everyone will come after you and you'll be like, oh, I wasn't ready for that. Because you're a person that in alignment in yourself is only worth 1,000 views or something, and you're making videos that you're creating the fake hype is worth 200,000, a million views. Now you don't have that foundation if someone comes up to you and wants to work with you based on them thinking that you're worth that. Does that make sense? I love that made sense to you, because as I'm doing, I'm like, you're not clear enough here. So there's two me's talking, right? There's two me's going on. There's the me that can give you advice because I'm giving me advice. Because we give the greatest advice to everyone else, right? We give the greatest advice to everyone but ourselves. There's no question. You give amazing advice to everybody else, and it's always the advice you need to hear. It weirdly has half the time nothing to do with what they're talking about. They'll tell you their problem and you'll start to skew it to advice that's a certain thing that has to do with your issue, right? They'll be like, I just can't stop eating. And you'll be like, I think you need to break up with her. They're like, I'm single. I don't know what you're talking about. Because your advice is for you. We get very passionate about things that have to do with us, and we don't give a crap about things that don't have to do with us. We don't. Remember when Tiger Woods cheated? Everyone went batshit, right? Everyone went crazy. Why? Because they're somewhat, a lot of people do that, right? A lot of people do that or have an issue with that someone did it to them, so they can't talk about that. Weirdly, there's not a giant panel talking about the starvation problems in Kenya and stuff like that, right? They don't talk about that nearly as much, but a panel will show up and talk about Tiger Woods forever, and people will rant because they're able to yell at themselves indirectly, right? There's just no question that we get mad about things that we're more personally involved with, or we give advice based on what we're more personally involved with. So what's happening right now is the me that showed up before that's like, oh, I hope this goes well, is being coached by the other me that would give you the advice indirectly, because it's hard to give yourself the advice, right? Because there's two yous going on. So the advice part can't come through as well while your mind is full of the worried guy, right? So if I'm giving you the advice, then I'm suddenly free to hear it come through and I can just extrovert every single thing I need to hear. And the real reason I want you to know that too is because take whatever you want from this. you don't have to get every single thing in agreement with me. It's your life, and you take what you want from it. So many people get caught up finding the one thing about something that they don't like, and then they throw the whole thing out, right? Like the movie The Secret does this thing where they're talking about focus on what you do want. And that's a big deal, and that's very obvious to me, right? For me, that's a big deal when they go, focus on what you do want. What does that mean? Like, obviously, if you want to get fit, don't say, I don't want to be fat. That's a very good concept, right? You don't type into MapQuest, don't take me to Tacoma. And if you did, MapQuest would be like, well, that's all I can think of, so we're going there, right? So that concept is very obvious to me. Like, but people do that, by the way, as a side note. People do that all day. Ask most people what they want. We live in a world of victims. That's why you should be really thrilled that you're going to spend 3 days here. Because this isn't a world of victims. You guys are leapers. Do you realize that? You guys came here with no idea what I'm going to do. Even I don't know what the hell I'm going to do. But you had enough in you to say, let's jump, right? So take that in for a minute. Yeah, give yourselves a round of applause. Give me one. Give me a round of applause. I have no clue what the hell is going to happen. So, but that advice in The Secret is something that really resonated with me, right? But there's another thing in The Secret where they go, when you have a thought, what happens is it goes out physically, magically, and the universe responds. Now, I'm not saying that's not true, but that I don't know if it is or not. So what happens for me when I watch that movie is I go, okay, that part could be going that way, I don't know. But I do like this part of the advice, so I take it, right? But what skeptics do is they find one thing that they don't like and throw the whole thing out, right? They go, ah, see, he said that, it's totally a scam, he's trying to sell something or whatever. You know, I've heard people say that about some of the best seminars in the world. They'll go, oh, see, he's doing tricks to sell it. Yeah, but you still had your life changed by the other 3 days. Like, yeah, but he said this thing and now he's upselling. Yeah, well, people want to work with him and it's worth it. Who cares? Yeah, but this one problem. You know? And how about you just go, I'm going to take what I want. It's weird how much we take what we want when we look for external signs of stuff, right? We go, there's people I know that go, you know, well, that's a sign right there. You know, there's people, for instance, that wanted to come to my event. And then they said, I tried to sign up. And the computer didn't work in that minute, so I'm wondering if that's a sign I shouldn't go. And I said, yeah, but I'm calling you to tell you you should, so isn't that a sign too? Like, it's fascinating how many things we pick and choose to make a sign. And I said, well, maybe you're saying that because you're trying to make it that you don't want to go. I said, do you think maybe you don't want to go? I said, listen to your heart. You don't have to come. I said, do you want to go? And they go, no, I really want to go. And I go, that's exactly right. You do want to go, but your mind is scared to take a leap, so you're looking for any type of thing to be the sign, right? And we don't realize that our signs, in my eyes, are internal. There's some external signs all the time, and things happen all the time, but I think that's just a reflection of the internal because it's a reflection of what you're looking at. Because you're going to suddenly think everything that happens today is a sign. Because you're going to meet another person that's amazing and another person that's amazing. You'll be like, oh, all these signs, there's 200 signs in the room. Like, you're going to think that's a sign, but there's also signs internally. I have a friend that said to me, she wants to leave her company, but she needs to have a sign that she could do it. And I said, the fact that you said you want to leave it is the sign. You know, what are you doing? Waiting to drive by, get out of your company, drive? Like, what? There's no... The fact that you want to leave it is something. But we've been trained to not listen to that feeling. And that feeling is that's the real thing to me. And I don't take things into consideration before I listen to that feeling, because that feeling has never been wrong. You've always had that feeling. Every one of us has experienced being in a relationship that we knew we were supposed to leave earlier because we felt that feeling, but then we logically justified why we should stay. And then we stayed there until everything kicked our ass and made us leave, right? If you ignore that feeling, everything will kick your butt until you leave, right? Not literally leave here. You can, you don't have to go. It's not, so, oh, that's a sign I'm doing bad. So... Because isn't that true? Like, if every time you feel you should leave this company or you should ask that person out or you should go here, you feel that thing. And when you ignore that thing, what happens? You just literally stress until you go for that thing. Or you have to numb it with an addiction or something like that, right? Because now you're arguing with intuition. Because you know that there's two voices, right? There's two voices. There's the first voice that says, let's do it. It's instant. It's a leap feeling. But society has taught you to listen to the dumb voice, the why you shouldn't voice, the scared voice. You've literally trained yourself to feel two doors, and one feels amazing, and then the other one's the one that doesn't. The other one's scary, right? So the first voice will be like, we should leave this company. It just feels good. It can't tell you why, right? How could it tell you why? You haven't done it. It can't give you any physical proof because it's a feeling. It's a feeling of freedom. It's really good. We should do this. And then the second voice will come in and justify why you shouldn't. Well, if we leave this company, we can't go to the Cheesecake Factory party next Thursday. And the first voice is like, it can't tell you this because logic doesn't talk through the first voice. Passion and feeling talks through the first voice. But if the first voice could talk, it would go, if you'd learn to listen to me, you'd own all the Cheesecake Factories in a week. Do you understand that? And the second voice is like, yeah, but they're giving away free Thai lettuce wraps. And the first voice is like, if you'd learn to listen to me, your life would be so different. So all the time, you'd feel these things, but you take into all these things to consider, and basically you train yourself to listen to the second voice. And that's what we have a society of people that do. We have 98% of the society only listens to the second voice. They only listen to it. They just hear it. There's two doors. The first door feels good, right? We should leap. It feels really good. I can't tell you why, but we should. It feels good. That's a preview. If you do it, it'll feel like this all the time. You'll feel free. And then the second voice comes in why you shouldn't. So picture that there's literally two doors. One's this heaven feeling of unknown and possibilities and excitement and everything. And another one, it's just on fire. And you're like, well, I only know how to go in the fire door. So, because that's all I do. And you'll find this mainly when you ask your mom what you should do. Because no matter what, mom will come up with why you should. Well, what if the house falls apart? What if there's a tsunami? So that's mainly for people who have my mom. Anybody have my mom? So a couple of you? Okay, great. No, my mom's absolutely amazing. I love it. And that's funny because I think the reason I do this is just to get her to say I'm proud of me. This isn't really the, you know, and if it's not her, I'll just take 200 people for a 3-day. I'm like, does this prove it yet? Am I good? So that's all this is, really. If my mom just said I'm proud of me, none of you would be learning anything this weekend. You'd be, no, she does. She's very proud of me, but we all perceive how we take it, right? So it's a totally different thing. But now I'm starting to see, like, things are going well. Things are doing well. I'm very happy. But I'm happy because I listen to that first voice. I literally only listen to that first voice. At times, the other one lingers in, but more and more, you're going to listen to that first voice, and it's a feeling, and you have it all the time. Just ask her out, or it'll be like, no, don't. Leave this. Get in this. Jump. Do it. Yeah, but you don't know what you're losing by not jumping, because your mind always analyzes what you'll lose if you do, right? That's why I love this group. In fact, sometimes I get tempted to raise the shit out of the price, not because I want to make a bunch of money, but because I want to find the highest level leapers. Do you know what I mean? Because I notice that when you go lower on the price, you get more skeptical people and they don't jump. You go up to like $1,000. Like I was at Bob Proctor's event and I spoke and I said the tickets are $3.99. And you know how many people said to me, oh, I'm scared to go because it's so cheap. And I found that it's just fascinating because there's two types of people. There's the people that find why everything's BS. And you know what they do too? They say, you know, I'm not going to spend money to go learn a thing. You know what they're saying? I'm not even worth $100 or $500 or whatever the thing is for them to do it. They think that they're that limited thing. Well, what if you figured out you're worth infinity? What if you really embodied that? Not a sentence you repost on Facebook. You really embody and understand that you're worth infinity. Because I'm understanding it more and more every day. There's an unlimited amount of creativity that comes out when you unhinge all this shit. And when you're in that creative flow, you can take your business through the roof. You can do more of what you really want. You can figure out ways to make money. You see that there's assets all kind of ways. But really, the only thing stopping you are one of two things, money or what people will think of you, right? That's the only thing that stops you from every single thing you want, right? You always go, what will they think of me if I do that? Even if you think you don't, you do. That's what the indirect thing is. Well, I want to go perform, but what if I do it wrong? Then what? The audience won't like you, is what you're saying. And almost every decision we're making is, what will that person think of me? And a lot of times, the more related to them or the longer you've known them, the more they really are the ones that you tie to. You know, what will my husband think? What will my wife think? Because we've created a story that we're these two people that just go to these restaurants and we do these things and we don't go do what we want to do. You know, we kind of just negotiate every single thing. We say, what do you want to eat? I see so many couples do that, you know, and I respect couples, but I think the coolest thing would be to be in your alignment and have someone in their alignment, right? Because you literally see people at restaurants going, what do you want? Because you're trying to figure out what you want, right? Do we want pancakes? Well, yes, the team decided on pancakes. And you ignore your intuition. But you are ignoring the fact that you're asking him if he wants pancakes, which means you want pancakes. Just order pancakes. Right? Because your intuition is asking, it's guiding that. How many times do you have your intuition show up, but you don't even notice that that's your intuition? Like when you ask someone for advice, but you specifically ask someone that you know will give you the answer that you need to hear. Right? Do I break up with this person? Okay, who hates him? Right? Why? Who's talking there? Your intuition is saying, I want to get out. Have you ever even guided someone into giving you the opposite advice that they gave you? No, I think you should stay. Yeah, but he's a douche. Yeah, I think you should stay. Just please tell me to leave him. Okay, leave him. Okay, thanks. Thanks for the advice. You just got your advice that you wanted anyway, so why not start the practice of cutting out the middleman, hearing that feeling, and jumping? Hearing what your advice is and just making the decision. Do you understand what I'm saying? You don't need to check in with everybody because first of all, most people's answers will come from their fear. Their answer will come from making sure you don't do anything that will challenge who they are. You know, should I move to that state where I really want to live? And they're thinking, well, no, then I have to move. Or they're thinking, no, then I'm not doing enough with my life. And I literally, most people live their life comparing themselves. So if you're asking people for advice, they're going to tell you their fear. So you're literally starting to ask their fear over your soul. Right? That's what we do all day. The second you say, what should I do? You just said, I'm bypassing this internal guidance system that Kelly talks about so beautifully. I'm bypassing my GPS. Did I just do all your stuff? I'm bypassing it. I'm ignoring it. C steals from Carlin. Joe Rogan video come out, me at the Comedy Store. I am in the weirdest world, you guys, because my following is now cynical comics and cast members of The Secret. That's my following. I have no, it's weird because we live in a world where you have to have a label, right? So every person's asking me, what are you now, a comic or a motivational speaker? And I'm like, how about I'm Kyle? How about I say what I feel like in the moment? How about I can have all kinds of different ways of expressing myself? How come we have to label everything? What if you're only this moment? You suddenly lose all those titles and those stories. I'm someone who went through this. You even can lose, I'm that person's spouse, because what does that mean when you say we're together? Future. Right? Because right now, we're together. That's what's actually true. We're together, and I'm going to have a hell of a party with you tonight. No, I'm just kidding. Wouldn't that be weird if I slept with you? But you would forget about it, because it'd be the next day, and it's in the past. I'm going to get you so in the moment that none of you will remember what I do to you. So, that's what I do. So, it's really big that you realize that you listen to that voice. You did. You're already people that are halfway there because you came to this. You came to this on the fly. Some of you came from different seminars. You're already somewhat leapers. But that little thing, that inner voice, is a big deal, man. Because that voice is just a feeling. I mean, don't you think a feeling is advice? Right? But we've literally trained ourselves to find why it sucks. We go on the news all day. We go on the news and it's just, it'll feed the ego. It'll go, okay, here's a bunch of other crap that has literally nothing to do with you, but here's a lot of pain. We selected out of the whole world a family that was murdered somewhere. We selected some plane crash a while ago that's not even happening right now. Here's footage of a plane crash a month ago. I mean, we talked about Michael Jackson's death for 2 years, you know? How about focusing on everyone that's alive? There's a lot of celebrities that were still alive at the time, you know? You can focus on that too, because there's good things happening. But the news goes, no, bad, bad, bad. And weirdly, you've created an addiction to bad. Where's the problem here? That's what everyone thinks. There was a study where they tried to give people free money. They just went out in the street and were like, free money. And people are like, no. People have trained themselves to go, why won't it work versus how could it? How could it is where I live. How could it or what? You know, there's literally no problems to me. Like, I mean, I have some that show up, but more and more when something happens, I just go, oh, how do we make that work? How do we make that work? You know, there's situations where someone on the crew will be like, you know, we have to, you know, we're going to be short for time here. Or we have this thing here. I'm like, oh, okay, I'll just do this segment in there. Or I'll just say this thing here. Or, okay, I just won't go on then. Well, don't you need to? No, I don't have any rules because I don't have any expectations. I'm wide open, right? And because of that, it's just a giant playground. It's just that childhood state of just, hey, let's go on the swing and then the slide, you know? And if someone goes, hey, they're taking on the slide. Okay, we'll just go on the swing twice. We'll go on that spin around merry-go-round thing that someone will get become unconscious from. That absolutely should be a legal toy that is at the playground that they spin around violently. But that's just because all of that's because you had that instinct and then you go into a classroom and what happens in the classroom, they teach you, remember this, remember this, remember this, to a group of different people, all these different types of creativity in the room. Remember this, write down this, remember this, write down this. And I'm not going to be a conspiracy theorist here, but they make a lot of factory workers that way. You know, a lot of people that'll work for a good mid-level. Because if you take away from people the ability to know what they're really capable of, then you can sell them crap. Then you can get them to do mediocre things for you, right? I go on radio shows sometimes and I'll talk about this and they'll stop me. I'll be like, what? And they'll go, well, we got to sell stuff. Like, these people can't. I'm like, are you saying what I think you're saying? Like, yeah, you can't say that stuff because we got to sell stuff to these people and they have to think that they're a piece of shit and then we can sell them Guess jeans because that'll make you somebody. That I get stopped from that. Don't you think it's weird that you hear this and it just seems so obvious and freeing and you don't see it on NBC or CBS, right? And whenever someone really does show up and finally do it, they end up killed. I'm looking forward to that. But that happens all the time, right? Because two reasons. One, there's people that make a lot of money and you not knowing this. And then two, what we're doing is a threat to a lot of people. It's a threat to a lot of people's egos. You becoming something for some reason matters to other people. You know, if you're mad about anything, you're already in a victim state. If you're mad about things outside of you, you're in a big victim state. If you're saying my happiness is dependent on what other people do, that's crazy. But we do that in relationships, right? We say, I love you. Here's all the things you can't do. And if you do any of that, if you call your ex or anything like that, I'm going to be pissed, right? I'm pissed based on what you do. Now, who's the strong person here? You're not strong either because you're literally saying I'm a victim to every single thing you do, right? So we live in a world that's trained to be a victim to that. You're mad about what your football team did, or you're happy what a football team did, or you're mad what Justin Bieber did or Miley Cyrus did. And all these people that are not doing anything with their life feel entitled to have an opinion all day and mad about all these things that are happening that have nothing to do with them. And you're missing out on something so fulfilling because I'm starting to see that and the life that I'm getting to feel is so fulfilling. Like, I get to just show up and do this. I get to do this. This 3 days is so magical to me. I did this in LA before, and it's already different content coming out now, and it's my favorite thing to do. Or I could be at home scrolling through Facebook. Or you could be scrolling through Facebook. Think of that. What would you be doing otherwise? Maybe some of you would be doing some awesome stuff, but a lot of times if we don't have any intention, if we don't have an intention for our day, we just let the day run us. That's why they can put a McDonald's on every corner, because people don't have an intention. I'm here to get healthy, right? I'm here to become real. I want to be the healthiest person I can be. Well, because you don't have any aim, you're just aimless. And they can put a McDonald's on every corner. Here, you eat here, you eat here. Bam, Facebook. Put a million things on Facebook and they'll just be like, ah. And you'd be like an animal in a cage that doesn't know it's in the cage because they can just keep putting stuff in the cage to distract it from the idea that it's in one, right? If you're an animal in a cage and they just keep throwing candy bars and M&Ms in there, you just feel, oh, okay, this, this, this. But you guys are going to experience 3 days out of the cage. What would that be like? What would it be like? Because once you leave it, your awareness goes up. You guys are spending 3 days raising your awareness. This is a real thing. Because once your awareness is higher, you can't unknow it. Could you imagine if Keanu Reeves' character left the Matrix and then went back in it? He's just like, well, I know that I can jump buildings over here. This isn't real. That's how I feel. Literally, I go, oh, that's not real. People talk to me all the time about something that's a very circumstantial thing, like, ah, oh, my football team lost or whatever. I don't even have sympathy for it because I see it like Keanu Reeves did. Oh, that's just a digital image. That's not a real thing. you can do so many more amazing things. Ah, that guy said I'm a jerk or whatever, or that guy cut me off earlier, and you're mad about circumstantial things. That'd be like if Keanu Reeves left the Matrix, went back in, and he's literally hearing the digital cake, and it's a software, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's not real. So your awareness is going to be leaving because you're going to experience this weekend very shifting type things. Different things that'll cause you to literally see the illusion that you're under. In fact, you probably already, and I know I already feel a higher awareness just from doing this, so you probably will keep going. And what'll happen is you'll start to literally see that illusion. I mean, imagine already the things you've heard and that I've already heard myself say, and then we go back to the other world. That sounded like a cult. But we go back there, and what happens? There's people that say all these things, or they're telling you what you shouldn't do, and you're already seeing that's an illusion, right? So your awareness is higher. How much would that accent your life? How much would that change your life? How many different things would happen? So one thing I'd like to do before we start, I almost said before we start, but I feel like we started a while ago, actually. I'd like to just find out from you a few things that you guys want to get out of this weekend.